available. And so if they don't have guidance and support, they do this and do that and do this and really kind of get it in a kind of hodgepodge way. Mm-hmm. So still, I say to young people, you know, find a teacher, find a mentor, find the one-on-one touch. Because the other thing that frightens me about our young people is they don't have connection. Mm-hmm. They have contact,
yes,
and contacts and likes and friends.
Yeah.
But they don't know how to connect, you know, in a real meaningful way. So find a teacher, find a mentor that in your learning, growing, healing, you still have guidance, you know, and that you're not making it up on your own.
Okay. And healing.
Hi, I'm back. I'm still in London, and look at the press corps. Show them the
press corps. Hi.
Say hi, all the press corps. So they're asking me questions, good questions. I have good answers.
So the next question, who'd like to ask another question?
Yes, beloved.
Yes, Bridget. First got to see you after so many years.
Yeah.
My question is that the Tory business, you can fix your life. So what do you expect to gain from hearing you lecture and speaking, etc.?
Oh, I don't know what you expect to gain. Really, I don't try to make that up.
Okay.
Everybody's going to get what they come to get. Some people are coming to see Iyanla Vanzant because she's got a TV show. Other people are coming to see Iyanla Vanzant because they like her text and her tweets. And some people are coming to see Iyanla Vanzant because their friend got the ticket for free or whatever. So people are coming for a variety of reasons. I'm coming to bring whatever message the Holy Spirit gives me in the moment. I have no idea what I'm going to talk about tomorrow.
Wow.
Nor do I need to know. I don't know until the people gather and are in the room. And I have to speak to their spirit, not to some concept that I made up in Maryland.
Yeah.
You know, I don't even know where I'm at. I know I'm in Brixton, but you understand, I don't speak from that place. So I don't know, but this is what I do know. I do know that people think they're coming to see me or hear me, when the truth is they're coming to connect with each other. I think the power of what is going to happen in that room tomorrow will be all of those people being together, looking at each other, touching each other, supporting each other, asking each other questions. Well, it's not about me. That's too much power. You know, that's giving away too much power. I'm just a tool being used. Because what else? Or how else in this day and age, with what's just happened here and what's going on here, with this many black people come together in the room right now? This ain't about me, this is about you all. And I don't know what you're going to get, but I hope it's good.
Thank you. Great question. Anybody else?
Well, they're quiet now. Yes. Yes.
Okay.
Hi, I'm Maya Lantrina.
Hi, Judy.
I watch your show, It's My Life, a lot, and I feel like a lot of people that come to you, a lot of their issues are from like a lot of childhood experiences and stuff, but they come to you as adults. So maybe, my question is, as a young adult or maybe teen, is there something that you could do or practice you could do to sort of heal or go on a healing journey from young rather than being an adult and then having to express and like unveil things from childhood?
Well, the problem is you won't know how your childhood has affected you until you become an adult. And until you recognize, okay, wow, I don't know how to create loving relationships because I didn't see one. Oh my God, I am financially illiterate because I grew up in poverty. Or, oh, I don't like the God that my parents gave me, so I'm going to just leave God alone. You know, you don't know any of that until you start experiencing life and going through life. And that's what life is about. It's about shifting and learning and changing and growing and healing. So don't think that, you know, you get this formula, you drink this juice, that you're going to be able to do it all right. You'll be doing it. That's what life is. growing, healing, learning, shifting, changing. And it's fun, really. Look at me. Do I look worse for the wear?
All right.
Excellent. Are there any other questions?
Yes. Hi, my name's Simone. I'm a mental health activist and I work with children who experience childhood trauma. And my thing is, I know that on average it takes 20 years for someone to speak about their trauma. And I spoke out about mine, and people were always like, of my age, I was so eager to speak out about it. And my thing is, how do I help younger people to kind of gain that forgiveness or try and gain it? Because I always said to myself, I didn't want to be like 40 or 50 years old discovering. And I did discover, I was aware that I was going through things at my age. I was like, no, I need to kind of knock on it. So how do we help children be able to kind of go on that journey?
I think the way we help anybody is, first of all, love them. Don't feel sorry for them. And don't cripple them because they've had difficult experiences. See them higher and expect the most from them. That's first. I think the second way that we support or serve anybody is to tell the truth about our experience. I think that's what really has been the foundation of my work in the world. I tell the truth about where I'm strong, where I'm weak, where I'm good, where I'm not good. I tell the truth as I owe it in the know it in the moment. There are things that I spoke about 20 years ago that have shifted for me, you know, that I write differently about that. And I don't need anybody's agreement with my truth. This is my truth as I know it in the moment. Let me offer it to you. If it serves you and supports you, then we can discuss it. If it doesn't, I'm okay with that. So I think that that's the other thing. Be authentic. I mean, you know, children, young minds and young hearts, they need very little. And they're very flexible and pliable. And that's why they get so wounded and broken, because parents aren't careful. Care, C-A-R-E-F-U-L-L. They're not care-filled or careful with how they shape and mold those in their minds. So be authentic with them. Tell them your story. But don't think that because you healed it, that they can heal it. Because for some people, the journey is to walk unhealed until the time they're ready. Everybody ain't ready at 16 or 25. Some people are not going to be ready till 35 because they have to see how the break manifests in their life. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
So just love them, tell them the truth, and give them permission to do, you know, whatever they do, how they do it. You got to give people permission to be who they are. And you can't want it for them more than they want it for themselves.
Yes.
I think one of the greatest things that I learned in my work, and you know, when it came out of my mouth one day, I was horrified. I wanted to just run screaming. Somebody asked me a question, and I said, I really don't care if you get healed. That ain't my job. My job is to teach the lesson and write the book and speak the speech as I speak it. And what you do with it is your business. I can't run around trying to figure out if y'all are going to get everything. I can't do that. And trying to do it was making me crazy. But, you know, to say it sounded so horrible. I don't care if you get healed. But I know. I have to be focused on my healing. And my healing comes with doing and being obedient. That's how I got healed. God said, do this. You know, when I started this work in 1995, people weren't talking about spirituality out loud.
Mm-hmm.
And nobody black was talking about it. You understand? So I not only had to fight the fear and the rejection of the people, and I don't know if y'all remember, at that time I used to always wear African
garments.
Yes.
It was always white and whites, you know? And one day the Holy Spirit said to me, Iyanla, people have Afrophobia. They can't hear you if they scared of what you look like. Take them clothes off. I had to be obedient. So then I had the little afro, you know, I wore, you understand? I had to do that for 15 or 20 years. And then, you know, got that bowl, let me shave half the hair off. And he was locked in. So I've grown up in front of you, just being authentic as who I am. You know, so you, I can't tell you the number of people who like freaked out when I shaved this and straightened my hair. Oh my God, y'all might have straightened her hair. I said, here's the thing, her hair.
Right.
You don't have to straighten your hair, but it shows how we get so caught up in the image that we can miss the heart. Has my heart changed? Has my soul changed? That's what I'm giving you change. What do you care what I look like? You understand? So I just have learned over the years that the growing and the healing and the unfolding. And I've seen people change before me, like Angie. Like Helen, I've been there and I've watched you change and I've seen the consistency. I've been consistent from the beginning. My first book, Tapping the Power Within. Not tapping the power in Iyanla. Not tapping the power on social media. Not tapping the power in your mama. Tapping the power within. That was my first book. I've been consistent. Yes, beloved.
Proliferation. No, no, proliferation. Let's go here first.
I just want to say I love your work and I love who you are. And I really believe that we, as a time of where we're living right now, we're going through a transformation as a people, as a nation. And it's very important for us to really be centered and anchored in who we are. And I just want to say that what your work brings to us is really profound in terms of it helps us to connect with them. So my question to you is that sometimes people carry a lot of what we call emotional baggage and pain. And sometimes they find that they're carrying what they call patterns or blocks that they can't break through. And it sometimes repeats in cycles and they can't really see the way out of it. Is there ways in which you recommend for people to actually break chains or break patterns that sometimes they keep pervading the experience? But also I wanted to, I'm from also conscious radio, and also we play your forgiveness tour when you did in the USA on air, so people really loved it, didn't they? I'm just recording so I can play back to them. So I just want to rise up. We're here with the Iyanla Vanzant. And I want to, one last question to you. In the area of health, a lot of us brothers and sisters are going through challenges around physical manifestations that come from emotional hurts and pains. How do we stop the manifestation or be aware of things prior to manifesting in the reality that we live in? Because people, our sisters are suffering from prostate, from fibroids, and our brothers are suffering from prostate problems. But we don't relate that to the emotional challenges that we're going through. So I don't know if you can highlight anything that we can do as a community, as a nation, to help us to heal.
Okay. You know, and I'm amazed because in January, my 19th book will be released. The title of that book is Get Over It. Prayers and Affirmations for Healing the Hard Stuff. And what I address in that book is dominant negative thought patterns and how they become established and how they manifest in our lives as conditions. And rather than give a whole lot of psychological theory, I give you a prayer and an affirmation to deal with it. Really, it's just that simple. Get over it. And you know, because we do, as you say, have dominant negative thought patterns that are passed on from generation to generation. We inherit them like our hair, like our eyes, like our nose. Patterns of poverty. Patterns of value and worth, or limited value and worth. Relationship patterns, generational relationship patterns of family breakdowns and family fall apart. And so the reason I did the book was because it's your mind. You got to change your mind. And when it comes to dominant negative thought patterns, we really need to alter the structure of our DNA, the molecular structure of your DNA. And Dr. Umoto, I can't remember his first name. Umoto. Right. He talked about how words can change the crystals in water.
Yes.
And the human body is 98% water. Mm-hmm. Come on now. Mm-hmm. It's just science. Yeah, that's just, you want to be intellectual? It's science. So if we can change the crystal in water and drink it and impact our health and our body, then we can change the chemical structure of our DNA based on how we think and what we speak. So I'm looking at dominant negative thought patterns. I'm broke. I can't. I'm stupid. I'm ugly. I'm alone. I'm hurt. I'm abandoned. Deep divided. Blah, blah. I look at 42 dominant ones that I found among women, number one, and among people of color, number two. And I offer you a prayer and the affirmation to say over a period of time so that you can get over the dominant negative thought pattern. And that'll happen in January.
Thank you.
Because it is showing up as our, it's showing up as diabetes,
yes,
hypertension, heart disease among women of color is growing because of the level of emotional abandonment that we have visited upon ourselves. And it is showing up in men as prostate cancer, African-American men. And the one thing an African-American man was known for and needed and identified with is his pieces and parts. So now if the pieces and parts is ain't working, Lord Jesus, what are we going to do? What else going to do? I just think it's another way that dehumanizes and diminishes black men who have already been devalued and stigmatized. And you know, the number of, I don't know how it is over here, the number of African-American men in prison, and then they come out and they can't be re-accepted into the world. It's just a mess. What else going to do? We're going to pray and meditate. Yes. Thank you, brother.
I was really impacted today in the conversation with my friend James, and we were speaking about healing, and to heal and to tell the truth. And as part of that, I really want to give a bit of attention to both a lot of black men and particularly black men. And I'd like to give some attention to black gay men, which I am one.
Mm-hmm.
And just maybe some word that you might have, because so many of us struggle perhaps with mental health issues because we've had to cultivate our sexuality in secrecy and in shame, and to then tell the truth becomes so difficult, it becomes so hard to be in intimate relationship with ourselves and with others. And I guess sometimes in even these sorts of conversations, it can feel like the conversation is for women, and I know it's not. And I very often live the sense of having to adapt a lesson in order to receive this. And I just wondered if you might just give something from your heart for me and for the people.
See, then I'm separating you. Unless I say women specifically, women particularly, the lesson is the lesson. And you don't understand how you perpetuate your own diminishment by not telling the truth.
Mm-hmm.
You want us to specially speak to you as a gay man? No. Gay is how you self-identify. I'm not gay, so I can't identify with you. But I can identify with your truth. I don't care who you sleep with.
Mm-hmm.
Neither does God.
Mm-hmm.
God wants friends and servants, not slaves. And so if I start to say, for gay men it's this, for gay women it's that, no. Then I'm tying it into the same thing that people use to diminish and dismiss you. You understand? If I have to learn, and you need to show up in the room knowing you're a gay man, being okay with being a gay man. You understand? And presenting yourself to me as a gay man, as you identify with it. I don't show up in the room saying I'm a heterosexual. I don't. But I show up in the room as a black woman. And I know I'm a black woman. And I stand in that. And I honor that. And nobody can take that away from me. What would that look like? What would you need to do to show up like that inside first? You understand? And not have to announce it. Or have it validated by anybody. I don't need anybody to validate me as a black woman.
Yes.
You understand? That's what I want for you.
Yes.
I don't want to have to separate you because you're a gay man or a gay woman. I want you to be so solid in it within yourself that you don't have to put that label on you. And then you live your life that way because that's what, who you are. Does that make sense?
Yes.
And I don't want you to think I'm diminishing you.
No, you're not.
Okay.
We are talking about the inclusion, and
yes.
I receive that.
Yes. you know? But every time you say, I can't stand in my truth because I'm gay, you're playing the game that they want you to play. The same laws of the universe, cause and effect, correspondence, balance, polarity, attraction, they work for you. They're not going to work no different for you because you're gay. Line up with the principle and the law will work.
Mm-hmm.
Integrity, accountability, responsibility, humility, compassion, honor, integrity, respect. They're not going to work for you any differently because you're gay. Just line up with it. Validate yourself. Don't ask anybody to agree, accommodate, or accept you. Do it first, and you set the standard that people have to live up to. Almost as a creator, it's not Iyanla, it's Iyanla. I can't let you call me what you want to call me.
Right.
My name is Iyanla. Now, I work with you on how to say it. You understand? So don't let people diminish you, dismiss you, dishonor you because of what they think gay is.
Yeah.
No, no. What do you think it is?
But it's love.
Yeah.
It's love. Yeah.
And it's authentic.
Absolutely.
And it's okay.
Yeah.
And it's all God.
Yes. So what's the protocol?
I'm sorry.
Great question. Okay. Great answer. Last two, I'm going to this young lady and then Donna. So this young lady. I'm just trying to keep to time.
Okay.
Hi, Amber. I really appreciate you being here with us today. My name is Jamelia Donaldson, and I'm here on behalf of Design Essentials, but I also have my own business called Treasure Trust. So I basically help women discover products that work for them.
Yes.
Not too long ago, I embarked on a self-development journey, and I've always grown up around your books and your wisdom. Something that I've taken to particularly is living an authentic life, so doing what I want to do. So 2 years ago, I quit my job in corporate to focus on my business to do it full time. But something that I'm battling with at the moment is just allowing myself to live authentically without self-judgment. Do you have any advice on minimizing self-talk and self-judgment in order to facilitate a really successful authentic life?
Let me just, please make a note on you. Iyanla don't give advice. I've been married 3 times. Advice is a nasty thing. I can share the principles. And you're young. You know, I got underwear older than you. You know, I don't know, because experience has taught me how to do it. I don't know if I know the formula, you know, because I wasn't paying attention. But you've got to know that who you are, just as you are, is enough. Start there. My presence is enough. I don't have to convince anybody. You don't have to like me. My presence is enough. Just my presence. That's why it's important for you to be clear and hear about your presence. Who are you? You know? And then, that's the beginning of living an authentic life. So I don't have to tell you lies. I don't have to make up stories. I don't have to convince you of anything. My presence is enough. And I think once you get there, then you can begin to ask for what you want. That's another thing about being authentic. Asking for what you want from life and from other people. You know, sometimes you may have to say, you know, I just really want to be liked. I don't know why I'm working on that right now. Right now I just want to be liked. Even if you don't say it out loud, say it to yourself. You know, I want to feel special. I want to at least be able to say it to yourself. I think that that is important. You know, I too walked away from my job as an attorney with 3 children when I was 33. And I had to walk through that journey, you know, losing my house and sleeping in a friend's basement, and then my teenage daughter got pregnant, and to go through all of that to get to here. So, but I knew that who I was enough. and no matter what, I was going to be okay. And I learned that deeper and deeper and deeper as I walked through the process. I didn't know it up front. And see, I think young people today want to know up front, this is going to be okay, before they start the journey. No. It's on a need-to-know basis. You got to start the journey and learn along the way, I'm okay, it's okay, I'm going to be all right, I can do this. You can't learn it. And young people want, when I say the young people, I'm talking 21 to maybe 30. They want to know here that it's going to be okay. But there are no guarantees. Know that your presence is enough. Tell the truth about what you want and what you're doing. And walk that path knowing that you're going to be okay.
Excellent. Thank you.
Last question.
Hang on, I'm Donna Spencer, comedian. I think you are funny. Everybody
says that to me. Everybody says that to me. I've never thought about it.
Well, you know, I'd be happy to share a stage with you. Okay. I just want to show, I'm going to bring you on because you were funny.
Yeah.
Thank you so much for everything you give us.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much.